Good morning. We give a warm welcome to all those joining us for our podcast service this Sunday morning. It is a pleasure to welcome back to lead our worship the Reverend Samantha Sheehan, University Chaplain to Young Adults, the 18 to 25-year-olds project. Notices: the funeral of the late Mrs. Margaret Chester will take place at Lawnswood on Friday, 16th of October at 2:25 p.m. Unfortunately, because of the COVID-19 emergency, only 14 persons are allowed to attend, and the family will therefore be sending personal invitations out. Donations in memory of Margaret should be made to the Parkinson Society online or by cheque. The Yorkshire Synod meeting, chaired by our new moderator, the Reverend Jamie Kissack, will take place on Saturday the 10th of October by Zoom video. Mrs. Joan McShane is our Synod representative. Thank you.
So we come to worship God this morning with words from Psalm 118. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. And so we pray. In the midst of humanity, with friends and neighbours, visitors and strangers, together we join to worship you, O Lord our God. Generous, hospitable God, who turns no one away, welcome each one of us now, in this time of worship and gathering, and embrace us in your being.
Amen.
We come in worship as we join in singing our opening hymn, a song of great praise. Great is thy faithfulness, O God my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassion they fail not. As thou hast been, thou for ever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand have provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Thank you.
we have sung our praises, so let's come to God with our confession. Let us pray. Glorious and gracious God, you are with us and call us into your presence. We lift our hearts in response to your love. We raise our song in praise of your goodness. We offer our adoration in response to your holiness. Summon us, voice of God, with words of challenge and grace, calling us to courageous discipleship and urgent witness. Speak to us, breath of God, with forgiveness of the many occasions we have hidden behind weakness, belittling your power and denying your presence. In a moment of stillness, we seek God's forgiveness for our mistakes and sins of the past week, and to know of God's overflowing love and mercy to renew us for the week ahead. Jesus said, "Friend, your sins are forgiven." Thanks be to God. Amen. This morning our readings are along the theme of encounters. I thought I'd take this opportunity to reflect a bit on my role within Synod as a university chaplain, and also as looking at how churches might be able to engage in 18 to 25 year olds. So we have two readings about encounters. Our first one comes from the book of Job in the Old Testament. Job, we're told, was a faithful man who feared God and turned away from evil. And yet we're told Job became the subject of great testing. Job is a story set on two planes, the earthly plane and the spiritual plane. It's a story of great drama, of riches to rags and back again, and the resilience of faith. On the earthly plane, we have Job, who was a prosperous farmer. He had thousands of livestock, a large family, and many servants. In the spiritual plane, we have the heavenly court between God and the accuser. The claim is brought before God that Job was only faithful to God because he was wealthy and everything was going well for him. God challenged the accuser for evidence, and so the trial begins with Job's testing. We enter the story as Job hits rock bottom. All that he had has been destroyed. His livestock, his servants, even his children were taken away from him in death. When this failed to provide evidence for Job's lack of faith, he was cursed with a great physical suffering and ill health. But this still failed to yield the desired results. We enter into Job's story as he sits in the tatters and ashes of his former life. A reading from the book of Job, chapter 2, verses 11 to 13.
From the book of Job, chapter 2, verses 11 to 13. Now when Job's three friends heard of all this evil that had come upon him, they came each from his own place, Eliphaz the Temanite, Bildad the Shuhite, and Zophar the Naamathite. They made an appointment together to come to condole with him and comfort him. And when they saw him from afar, they did not recognize him, and they raised their voices and wept. And they rent their robes and sprinkled dust upon their heads toward heaven. And they sat with him on the ground 7 days and 7 nights, and no one spoke a word to him, for they saw that his suffering was very great.
Our second reading comes from the Gospel of Luke. It may be a familiar reading, often heard in the weeks following Easter Sunday. It forms part of our resurrection narrative, where Jesus makes himself known to his followers in the days and weeks following his death and resurrection and before his ascension. We meet two disciples on their way home after witnessing the crucifixion of Jesus, their friend and Messiah. We assume they'd not talked to Peter or heard of the discovery of the empty tomb that morning, but were in the throes of grief and shock, because no one had expected Jesus to die in this way. Even at the last hour, there was a hope as Jesus hung on the cross that a miracle was going to happen. Into this story comes a stranger who overhears their conversation and stops to ask what has happened. And so we listen to a reading from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24, verses 13 to 29.
Luke 24, verses 13 to 29. That same day, two of them were on their way to a village called Emmaus, which lay about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and they were talking together about all these happenings. As they talked and discussed it with one another, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them. But something kept them from seeing who it was. He asked them, "What is it you are debating as you walk?" They halted, their faces full of gloom, and one, called Cleopas, answered, "Are you the only person staying in Jerusalem not to know what has happened there in the last few days?" "What do you mean?" he said. "All this about Jesus of Nazareth," they replied, "a prophet, powerful in speech and action before God and the whole people. How our chief priests and rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death and crucified him. But we had been hoping that he was the man to liberate Israel. What is more, this is the third day since it happened, and now some women of our company have astounded us. They went early to the tomb, but failed to find his body, and returned with the story that they had seen a vision of angels who told them he was alive. So some of our people went to the tomb and found things just as the women had said, but him they did not see." "How dull you are," he answered. "How slow to believe all the prophets have said. Was the Messiah not bound to suffer this before entering upon his glory?" Then he began with Moses and all the prophets and explained to them the passages which referred to himself in every part of the scriptures. By this time they had reached the village to which they were going, and he made as if to continue his journey, but they pressed him, "Stay with us, for evening draws on and the day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. Thanks be to God for this reading of his word.
We begin this morning with a question. Who has been an important part of your faith story so far? Can you recall the name of a person who's had an impact on you being a Christian? Someone who's helped you to know something of God? What was it about them? Did they do something that had an impact on you? Did they say something? Or was it their presence? Did they come alongside you during a challenging time? It might be hard to recall this person or what it was specifically about them. Don't worry too much, but it might be worth thinking about the next time you pause to pray and give thanks to God for who they are. There's been a number of people over the years who've had an impact on my faith journey. There was Sunday school teachers who encouraged us to explore the different stories in the Bible. There was a minister who encouraged me to start leading worship. But maybe more importantly than these was one person. She didn't know me very well. We'd said hi a couple of times and she was a very friendly person. But she saw me. She noticed me and noticed when life was particularly challenging. She came and sat with me. She listened to my story, listened to what was happening in that particular moment. She held the silence when I didn't want to talk, and she shared some of her story, offering an alternative narrative, God's narrative, and suggested where God might be present in my current narrative. Now, this sounds quite complicated, when in fact it was probably a 45-minute conversation or less. But in that moment, she was present with me in the place where I was. Over the last 2 years, I've been serving as university chaplain and exploring what young adults think about faith and the church and how the church or a local congregation might be able to reach out to them. In a nutshell, young adults are looking for places where they can belong, places where they can have an impact and connect with other people. They're looking for places that are safe, where they can explore ideas, ideas about themselves, about the world, about the local place where they live, places where they can push boundaries. They don't want to be told the answers, to fit in a precast mould, but to forge their own way in the world, to find their own path and to make a difference. They believe they have something to offer, something to give, but it might not be what we are expecting, or even hope for or wish for. We just need to look at the response to the call for climate action with the school strikes, which included universities and colleges, and the Black Lives Matter protests. Young people will not be silent when they believe in a cause and seek for real change to happen. But they do not believe the church is a place for any of this to happen. They don't see the church as a safe place to express doubt or to ask questions. They don't believe that they or their friends will be accepted in a church. And they don't recognise a church as a place to belong to explore their identity. Churches are old-fashioned, out of touch with the real world. They're places where people are criticised, told how to behave, what to think. They don't see what difference a Christian makes. They're not seeing the transformative presence of God within the life of the church or the lives of its members. And that's the problem, as well as the challenge. Because I think a lot of churches are wanting these sorts of people. They're wanting the enthusiasm and life. They're wanting to be places where young people, or indeed anyone, can grow and learn about the love of God for themselves. And even more importantly, I believe that God is wanting these sorts of people to be the builders and stewards of the kingdom of God. I don't want us to get too caught up in the doom and gloom or to argue about whether we feel as a church we are welcoming and accepting. Instead, I want to offer a model, a biblical model of what it might look like for a church and for us as individual Christians to engage with young adults. Or actually what it might look like for us to engage with anybody, because we are all looking for somewhere to belong, to identify with and experience something of love, mercy and grace. And the unique thing about a church is that this is the only place where those things can be found all together. No other community group can offer the same thing. Our reading this morning offers a model of being intentionally present with another person. What it might look like to come alongside someone else, not to fulfil our own needs, but to accompany another person on their journey. Job had lost everything. He's scraping the bottom of the barrel low. He's lost his home, his wealth, his health. He goes into a state of mourning, grieving for the life he once had. Three friends come and sit with him. Simple as that. At this part in the story, the friends are present with Job where he is in his grief. They don't try to lift him out of his sorrow, they join him in it. Their comfort comes from their presence, and in waiting until Job is ready to speak first. As the story progresses, they try and suggest ways in which Job could pull himself out of his stupor, offering another narrative, ways in which God might be active in his life. But for Job, these were not the answers, and yet his friends stayed and listened. In the same way, Jesus, the stranger to the two disciples on the Emmaus road, was present. He joined the disciples where they were and listened to their story. It was only after listening to their story that he offered a different perspective. He retold their story in light of the gospel story, showed where God had been active, what that story revealed about God in their lives. It was only after he journeyed with them, got to know them, understood their story and what was important to them, that he then offered an alternative narrative and helped them to see the glory in their own story. Jesus didn't invite the disciples to come to church with him, or promise that he would have all the answers. Neither did Job's friends. In the first instance, they were present. They listened. They asked questions. They took the time to hear their story, and then offered something of their own story and how God had been alive for them. This is something I've learnt from my work at the chaplaincy. This has become my approach to talking with students and staff. I've needed to learn what it means to be intentionally present, being in a place to watch, look, and listen, rather than having my own agenda, but to create time and space where folk feel comfortable and able to share something of their story. I invite them to tell me what's going on in their lives, just like the stranger asked the two disciples what was happening in their lives. And I listened. And then if it felt right, I'd share something of my story, something of God's story, or something of how God had been a source of strength for me. Or I'll share a biblical story, which had something in common with their story. I'd offer another narrative. Now, I don't always get it right. Sometimes the story I share doesn't find a connection. Sometimes I don't feel it's right to share something of God. And sometimes I regret not doing so. But each time, the intention is to be present in that moment for that person and to recognise God in that encounter. The joy about this approach is actually you can't get it wrong. We often hide behind the fear of not knowing the answer, but in this case, there is no wrong answers, because we're sharing something of our own story, something of who God is to us. Now that's very personal, and everyone has their own story. It is as unique to you as my story is unique to me. It's a challenge, and it may feel unnatural to begin with. But this, I believe, is part and parcel of being a disciple, of the call each one of us has to share in the good news. It's about sharing stories of what God has done in our lives and invites others to do the same. A good place to start is with friends and family, or when we're able to during coffee after worship. To start with someone you know quite well. Ask how they're doing. Listen to what has been happening in the last week. Ask if there are any challenges coming up. Even ask if they felt close to God this past week. And then share your own story. Maybe you feel able to pick up the phone this coming week and ring someone to talk. Ask for God to help you as you dial the number and be open to God's prompting in that conversation. Our starting point must always be to meet people where they are and to listen to their story. This is modelled time and again in Jesus' story, and it's the only way we can begin to break down the barriers which divide us. Let us pray. Loving God, you came and lived in the world around us. You came and walked beside all people, offering something of love and mercy, showing each person you meet that they are worthy of your time. We give thanks for all the people who have been a part of our journey so far, those who have encouraged us, those who have listened to us, and those who sit with us showing something of your love and mercy in their very presence. You call each one of us to be your disciples, to be your hands and feet in this place. May we be open to the encounters with others and have the courage to share our story with those that we meet. Led by your Spirit, we pray. Amen. We join in singing our second hymn this morning. The kingdom of God is justice and joy, for Jesus restores what sin would destroy. God's power and glory in Jesus we know, and hereafter the kingdom shall grow.
Prayer of Intercession. So often we want to pray for others, but sometimes, God, we don't know how. We can't remember names or numbers. Other issues weigh heavily on our hearts. Thank goodness, God, that you know what we mean when we pray. So we bring in this moment those names and faces, images and desires for others that pop in and out of our minds throughout the day. The old lady at the bus stop who needed a hand up the step. The young mum at the checkout trying to contain her four kids. The chap up the road who's lost his dog and is calling for him. The teachers struggling to understand the needs of those in their class. The doctors who want to give us more time but who simply can't. The young families who can't make ends meet. Those without work who can't find new jobs. Those helping people to find work knowing it is an uphill struggle. Those with mental health issues and seeking help. Or who are afraid and ashamed to seek help. Or who are ignored and can't get help. So, God, for all these people and countless others, we offer our prayers. We know you do not need reminding, but you do need willing workers, even us, to help them know your love and have their needs met. Hear our ramblings, O God.
Amen.
At this time, we pause using the prayer from Churches Together in England and pray for all those affected by the coronavirus. God, our rock and shield, we pray for our land and all nations and places in our world as many endure the effects of the illness COVID-19 and the coronavirus pandemic. For those who are ill, grant healing. For those who mourn the death of loved ones, bring comfort. For those who care for the sick, grant strength and endurance. For those who are isolated or whose livelihoods are threatened, give courage and hope. For all who take difficult decisions, from governments to health practitioners, give wisdom and compassion to accompany the knowledge and experience they bring. Deliver us from this disease, we pray, and enable all nations and communities to grow in collaboration and unity as we face this challenge together. Grant a legacy of enduring common purpose in facing all that threatens our global common good. We pray in Jesus' name, in the unity of the Spirit.
Amen.
We unite our prayers as we join together with Christians across the globe as we pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever.
Amen.
Our final hymn this morning sends us out into the world with a challenge to share what we know of God with others. With words of affirmation and the promise of God who goes with us, we sing, Go forth and tell. O Church of God, awake, God's saving news to all the nation take. Proclaim Christ Jesus, Saviour, Lord and King, that all the world his glorious praise may sing. May we go, Lord God, to meet the needs of others and to share the love we have from you. and may the blessing of God Almighty, Creator, Saviour and Sustainer, be with us now and for ever.
Amen.